It's Antonio in Edison, New Jersey. And how are you, Antonio?
I'm fine, thank you.
Thank you for waiting.
Oh, no problem. Thanks a lot. I appreciate being on the show. All right, so I'm here to prove the existence of God.
Oh, excellent. We always like to hear those.
But before I do that, I would like to, well, first of all, give a little background. I've always been raised a Catholic. My entire family's Catholic. My family's actually from South America, so you can guess how zealous people get there about Catholicism.
Sure.
But I was a Catholic until that last year, and last year what happened was I realized that Christianity couldn't solve many of the questions that I had, mm-hmm. and I decided to become an agnostic right after, because even though Christianity did not provide an answer to some of these questions that I had, I could also not disprove God. I was never able to say that God did not exist. And by definition, being an atheist would mean that I would have to disprove God.
Actually it doesn't.
Why do you consider yourselves atheist as opposed to agnostic?
Okay, well, first of all, you're operating from a very common misconception, so it's understandable that you have that. But the fact is that anybody who does not believe a God exists would be considered an atheist. There are other people who are atheists who deny that a God exists. Anyone who says, I reject the claim a God exists is true, would be an atheist. That doesn't mean that they then accept the claim there is no God.
And to answer your question about why we say we're atheists instead of agnostics, I actually say that I'm both. I'm an atheist in the sense that I don't believe in any gods. I'm also agnostic about the question of whether it could ever be proven that there are no gods. Because, I mean, you know, there are a lot of different ways to describe God, and I certainly wouldn't claim that I can go through every possible meaning of God and conclusively dismiss all of them. But I don't have any particular reason to believe in a God, so I'm an atheist.
Yeah, and that's mainly what it comes down to, is the question of when somebody says God exists, do you accept that claim? Do you accept that that is true? And if a person accepts that it's true, they're a theist. Anybody else is an atheist.
I guess I just misunderstood the dictionary or something. But,
well, what is in the dictionary?
Well, the dictionary just says that an atheist is somebody who rejects the idea of God, like, completely, whereas an agnostic is open to the idea of there being a God, but cannot either reject or accept such an idea.
Right. So depending on what you mean by reject, I mean, you know, I reject the notion of a God, but that doesn't mean that I conclusively...
Let me just say, like, for example, I said, what if I can't accept right now that Russell's story is true? I'm just not at the point where I can accept it. I need some evidence that what he's saying is true. If somebody says that rejection is not accepting, then I have rejected Russell's claim. That doesn't mean I'm calling him a liar. It means I'm having a hard time believing what he's telling me is true. I'm rejecting that it's true. I'm not accepting that it's a lie.
Okay. I understand.
I mean, some people get real confused by that, so it would be okay if you don't understand. But if you look at a broad range of definitions, don't just go to one book, but look at a lot of different dictionaries, theological dictionaries, philosophical dictionaries, and even just regular dictionaries, you're going to find some that say, you know, person who doesn't believe God exists, and you're going to find some that say person who says there is no God. You're going to find both those definitions.
Right, but I think that you'll find also that most people who are prominent advocates of atheism, I'm talking Richard Dawkins, Sam Harris, Christopher Hitchens, would all be working with this sort of tentative atheism that we're talking about, where basically they pretty strongly disbelieve in a God, but even Richard Dawkins says, you know, I don't put myself on the far end of the spectrum where I don't think there's any possibility of changing.
And what I normally say is that I cannot say there is no God with any more certainty than I can say there are no leprechauns. So in other words, I can't disprove that leprechauns exist. I can't. But I don't believe in them.
Okay, I finally understand the distinction.
All right.
For my proof, I came across this idea after reading up on some books on philosophy, including Immanuel Kant, which basically introduced me to the whole idea of utilizing a priori knowledge to find truths on top of truths.
Okay.
Basically, what my proof consists of is analyzing the fact that everything that we can say, everything that happens in this universe, or everything that happens in existence, happens for a cause. We can say that a priori, everything has a cause. That means that every cause there is has to have been preceded by another cause.
Well, there's a question, because this is not applicable at the quantum level of matter.
Mm-hmm.
But not even getting into like obscure science that gets missing. But we got an actual physicist in the room who's giving
me the thumbs up.
The question I would ask is does this generalization apply to God?
Well, that's what I was getting at.
Okay.
What first led me to believe from this theory, from this aspect of existence, was that the universe was in fact infinite, because if everything had a cause, then even if the Big Bang was true, which that's a whole other matter, but if the Big Bang was true, it must have been preceded by something else, and that something else must have been preceded by something else. And what first led me to conclude was that the universe was in fact infinite without possessing a beginning. Now, it is also true that
that's
both matter and...
That's not necessarily the case, by the way.
Okay.
I don't know if this is what Russell means, but one of the notes I just wrote is that once you get to the point of Big Bang, my understanding, and I am no cosmologist, is that the laws of this universe no longer apply, and you are working off of cause and effect, which would be strictly an example of how this universe functions. Once you get prior to Big Bang, you can't assume cause and effect are the law.
Right. Now, bear in mind, there are a lot of competing theories about the origin of the universe. I mean, there are some concepts where the universe is really just one universe among many within, you know, a metaverse, so to speak.
But even working with Big Bang...
Or there's one where, you know, there's an oscillating universe where the Big Bang leads to a big crunch, and then that just oscillates out into another Big Bang. There are a lot of different notions of where the universe came from, and there's no conclusive proof about anything, but it's not for lack of plausible theory.
The content of this video is produced by the Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and the separation of church and state. If you enjoyed this content and are willing and able to provide a donation, please visit the website below.